Harper Audio presents Go Mutants by Larry Doyle. Performed by Robert Petkoff. Through the infinite reaches of space, the problems of man seem trivial and naive indeed. Dr. Minton.
I hate all Earthlings.
James Dean. Chapter 1. Your flesh will crawl. She screams, as if that will help. Interior, high school, hallway, night. In black and white, and not art, a hot smudge of blind whites and ash blacks, this is the sorry noir of drive-in horror shows, the dreams of dogs and monsters. Enter right, screaming. The girl, in high distress and heels, she takes the corner wide, skips and skids into the lockers with a metallic wallop, ricochets and goes splat, displayed. In such a lovely and hideous dress, the girl claws for traction on the cold waxed floor. Her nails shouldn't shatter like that. She could use more zinc in her diet and less stress. And here it comes, into the light. Close on, the creature. Cranial sac engorged, strange fluids athrob, the lobes beneath its diaphanous skull crackling with spidery fire. Its big cat eyes loom with lust, or thirst, or the first to be followed by the second. As the creature reaches for her, its middle digit extends telescopically and impressively. The tip quivers along her pristine cheek, leaving an inappropriate residue. She screams again, her face meant to convey a complex interplay of terror and desire, not coming across at all. The creature's features collapse. Its feelings are hurt. She kicks off her heels, clever girl, and is up on stockings, slipping away, still screaming night after night after night after night. She should know by now that nobody's coming. A bit of a jumble next, an editor's breakfast of swish pans, smash cuts, meant to scare and disguise the lack of a usable master. The girl's wide eye, a blur of wall, the creature's dripping mouth, her frenzied rear end, assorted lights, some creature part, a flash of stock lightning, ending on her pretty, untorn face, her eyes darting, seeking, and at last finding room 51. The girl struggles with the knob. The creature is gangling up on her. Of course she screams, a terrible use of her limited time. The creature reaches for her with erectile fingers. The door is jarred loose by narrative imperative, and she exits, slamming. Interior, high school, room 51, day. The creature throws open the door. It recoils. The classroom is filled with human adolescents taking a test. Their instructor, Dr. Rand, glances up from his desk. Dr. Rand.
Jim, have you forgotten our exam this morning?
The creature is horror-struck. Human adolescent male.
That's not the only thing he forgot.
As one, the class looks down. The creature looks down and sees that it is naked. The humans laugh. The creature cannot hide its shortcomings fast or well enough. The humans giggle maniacally. This blends into a kicky 12-string guitar ostinato, and they begin to sing. Human adolescence, in close harmony.
It's the end of the summer. We're having a blast. They nuked the oceans, beaches turn into glass.
His lids opened, vertically, then horizontally, unveiling eyes many shades bluer than his skin. Jim Anderson lay in bed contemplating another day, another dollar, as a teenage alien on planet Earth. Inside the orb at his bedside, Brian Wilson sang,
"It's the end of the summer. Here comes a hard rain. They nuked the oceans. The waves are insane."
The boy's face wasn't half so monstrous in color.
His dusky blue-gray skin muted the ridges and spurs protruding here and there in patterns beautiful only to mathematicians, and his features were humanoid, if a little more oily in spots. His eyes were ultramarine, deep seas of whatever one wished to believe they were deep seas of, and kept in perpetual squint, which reduced their disturbing circumferences and made imitations of a soul. Delicate, respiratory slits suggested a vestigial cute nose, and his pouty lips were possibly kissable if situated on another head, and not periwinkle. His ears were independently rotational and highly emotional. His forehead was quite high, approximately 10 inches, and bulging with brains. But even this evoked the slick, upswept hairstyle favored by singers and delinquents without the hair. A girl with enough imagination might have found him attractive in a rugged, sun-dried sort of way. The girls at Jim's school did not possess that much imagination.
"Not just the end of the summer, looks like the end of the world."
Jim sat at the edge of the bed, the great mass of his head bowing his spine into a posture most adolescent males assumed voluntarily. This kyphosis, though mechanical, neatly expressed his ineffable burden, the world view he carried on his shoulders.
"Armageddon's a bummer. Looks like the end of the world."
The singer faded from the orb, replaced by the KBOM logo, which fissioned, leaving behind a pair of piggy eyes stuck in a slab of pea-green fat.
"Shiny!"
the eyes squealed.
"That was an H-blast from the past, from the rays, and this is..."
with maximum reverb,
"Marshall the Martian."
"In the morning," the Martianette sang, to which the orb jockey appended his catch ejaculation,
"Neep, neep."
Jim squinted his first hate of the day. With a pass of his hand, the orb muted. The newer models would have automatically skipped the cretin, but there were no newer models in this house. The walls around Jim were paint, not plex. The movie posters were physically present, artifacts from another era. The floor below him was fixed, and he would once again have to walk to the bathroom. He stood.
Crack.
Jim's nasal slits rippled. His day was about to become 50% more self-loathsome. He was alone, a small comfort. It could have happened later at school, in gym, and that would be fun. Or the cafeteria, like last spring, when Sally Fraser screamed and vomited on Hazel Court, triggering a chain regurgitation that got lasagna removed from the lunch menu permanently. Best to get it over with. Jim twisted his neck down and to the right. The seam between his cerebral hemispheres ruptured, revealing his next skin. Silvery cyan, bright and shiny, unmissable. His before skin retracted with a viscous crinkle, peeling back over two glistening humps of cerebrum, blatant beneath the fresh membrane that clung to every nook and sulcus. All his thoughts were on public view, synaptic bursts twinkling across his cranium, the area currently most active being his basal ganglia, or profanity center. His dead face fell away, leaving one that only wished it was, coated with a clear oil similar to petroleum jelly, but highly reflective and 30 times as aromatic. It did not wash, wipe, rub, scrape, scrub, or boil off. Gradually, the sebum would work into his new skin, darkening and dimming it to the pleathery exterior Jim could almost abide, but until then, Jim would be the greasy kid, subject to the customary names and jocularities, offering sweet respite to Bobby Harvey, an oil-producing human who was said to give girls blackheads simply by staring at them. The molt moved on, shuddering over Jim's sloped shoulders and sloughing off his sinewy arms, crawling down his angular, occasionally pointed torso, down his long, long legs, and pooling in underpants at his feet. Jim kicked off his old sleeve. It skittered under the bed.
"Shit,"
Jim thought, meaning himself, and began his morning shuffle, teen beasts slouching toward Armageddon, another day strewn with the idiocies and indignities he lived for, the petty evidence that he was right and they were human. A shame he didn't know he would be dead before the weekend was out. It might have spared him some anguish. This had been the kitchen of tomorrow only yesterday.
The Pluto Lux decor, guaranteed to last 24,000 years, had oxidized from white to grayish-yellow with olive spotting and had recently become unstable, cooking food left out on the counter and causing guests who sat in the chairs to appear in X-ray, a bit awkward. The cryo-magic magnet fridge was 10 years old and had gone out of phase, giving foods a tart, cancery taste. And the fusion cooker had developed a wormhole, exchanging entrees across galaxies. A green bean casserole might go in, but out would pop a giant Berenician dung daddy, which is not good hot. The worst of it was the plex nook. The built-in viz was minuscule and could no longer be turned off or lowered in volume or changed from PIN, and so the kitchen was a constant source of dubious news delivered by agreeable males and females, always human, ever since Gore from planet Arras, hired for the perceived gravitas of a gargantuan flying brain with eyes, used his program to bend viewers to his evil will after promising not to. The current informer, a young man with old sideburns, sat before a mortise of lightning branching from the ground into a night sky. The Chiron read, "Nocturnal Discharge."
"Tonight's plex release will be 23 teravolts," Tom Snyder intoned, "beginning at 1 a.m. and continuing for 6 minutes. While there is no danger from the emission, the president is asking citizens to step up their energy use in this time of excess capacity."
Jim skulked into the kitchen in his uniform of the day, every day. Black boots, size 16. Straight-legged lees, waist 19, length 38. White T-shirt. And slumped around a chair.
"In the tightly fought presidential race, Democratic nominee Jack Kennedy today denied that he is having an affair with his running mate."
Jim's mother was at the counter, her tail swishing in a slow, sensuous way that couldn't be helped. More feminine than feline, she filled her silk capri pants and pink cashmere sweater in an optimal fashion. Her pin-curled hair and short body fur were platinum blonde, plush and lustrous. On the viz, the four-term senator from Massachusetts spoke from the steps of the rotunda, an unfortunate choice given his own rotundancy, alongside his short-suffering second wife, Judith.
"Governor Baker and I have not been involved in that, way for a number of years, back when she was an actress and I was, good-looking."
The reporters laughed, as they always did. Jack Kennedy may have been a political joke, but he was a funny one, who might even win this time. A three-time loser, slimly to Nixon in 1960 of the former era, and then staggeringly to the president in the elections of 2 and 6 EI. Kennedy was 4 points ahead with less than a fortnight to go, owing to a buffoonish opponent with a scary running mate, and was favored to become the first ex-Catholic president, barring some last-minute surprise, which everyone expected. They would be sufficiently surprised, nonetheless. Jim watched his mother being gorgeous. How had he come out of her?
"And good morning to you,"
Mew teased, her back to him, in that breathy coquette that made Jim cringe, the asthmatic baby voice, because it always came with a little wiggle. No boy wants a sexy mother. Mew did a little wiggle and went on with her merry business. She pressed a glass against an upper cabinet, dispensing a thick black liquid, grabbed a small plate and turned. Her eyes were huge and blue like his, her lips also pillowy, but when she smiled, the resemblance vanished.
"Baby."
Her pink nose leather scrunched adorably. She shimmied over in unheeled pumps.
"That's 5 skins this year. You're getting to be as tall as your father was."
She poked his forehead.
"If you stood up straight."
Already at maximum hunch, Jim slouched his eyes.
"Baby,"
in her lower purr. She sat and petted his greasy arm.
"They only tease you because they're..."
almost saying jealous.
"Boys, drink your oil."
She pushed the glass at Jim. He ignored it, but his middle finger, sensing hydrocarbons, dilated at the tip, releasing the worm, as it was known colloquially. The wet, fleshy tentacles slithered forth up the sides of the glass and plunged in with a lewd, guttural suck.
Light sweet crude gave Jim natural gas, silent and deadly, but it was plentiful and practically free, and so long departed that Jim did not have to endure, as he did with animal and plant oils, the psychic aftertaste of how its source had been rudely butchered or brutally harvested. When he was 11, Jim created a comic book character with his affliction, the Black Phage, who solved murders by eating a piece of each victim. He never understood why nobody liked it.
In Japan, Gojira destroyed 6 blocks in downtown Tokyo this morning after becoming displeased with the daily offering. Officials there say the kaiju will not be disciplined in consideration of his long defense of the country, most recently against King Ghidorah, the three-headed space dragon, and Gigan, the giant chicken robot.
The blue worm gurgled and...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.